Hello everybody, welcome to another YouTube live session, and I'm just trying to get my, I'm looking to have my, here we go, let's see if my chat's actually going to work this time. It's a little bit confusing to see how that's going to work. Alright, looks like we're ready to go. So I'm going to take this thing, here we go, I'm going to take this away, and you see we've got ourselves a Free Folk Raider. I think that's a Raider Captain, not quite sure, but he belongs to the, here we go, Raider Leader, so that's what he's called. He's going to be painted along with the rest of his buddies here, so we've got unit of 12, this is a standard thing, standard unit for anything in Song of Ice and Fire, four guys in ranks of three. Figures are basically representational. So what we've got here is a few that we've done some of the initial colors on. We're also going to go backtracking to the beginning. And for those of you that are familiar with my oil painting methods, we're going to start out with our regular Winsor & Newton oil colors. We're going to thin those down in that preparatory glaze. And this is a key thing right here. So this is from Speedball. I think the individual brand name is Mona Lisa. See here it says odorless paint thinner. That really means odorless. You get the cheap stuff, you get the cheap stuff. And it's going to melt your eyeballs and your paint too. Neither of which is a good thing. You'll see as we use this stuff just how gentle this is on paint. And I can't smell it. I've held this thing underneath my nose and not sensed any of it. We're also going to use these guys right here. So these are from Mig Ammo. These are oil brushers. It's also oil paint. Okay. But it's going to be a little bit thinner. And you'll see as we work with this, you can see how thin that is. It's basically brushable just right out of the packaging. I like this packaging because it's hard plastic. You don't have to worry about punching a hole in your tube of paint. And you'll see the difference here. This paint comes out of here like peanut butter. So it's a good way, you know, if you're looking to get your paint right out there, not have to condition it first. The oil brushers are handy for that. They're pretty transportable. We're also going to use our makeup sponges. Here I'm going to tone down the color intensity just a bit here. What we're going to do is we're going to get this party started here. Now, not to belabor the fact, but we always use the bulk of our work with these number 8 round craft brushes. And these are from Hobby Lobby. You can get them from a lot of other places. But you can see it, $5 for 12, not a bad deal. And when they're new, they have a pristine point. They actually do a lot of detail. But even when they get beat up, worn down a little bit, they serve some excellent purposes. A filbert brush, which you're going to see as we work on our miniatures here. So I think I've got the chat where I can see it. For whatever reason, it did not load up on the screen. So I'm just going to give up on that. Not going to screw around with it. I'd rather actually just paint stuff. So let's get to the palette camera here. Yeah, let's make sure we got these in place right. So this is the raw umber here. That's the dark brown. I'm going to throw this out there. Then we're going to go with the Payne's Gray. Yeah, it looks black. It's not black. It's actually a really, really, really dark blue gray. And raw sienna, that's more of a reddish tone. And there we go. Now, if you do join in the chat and say something, it may take me a few minutes to see, because I chose the greater playback quality as opposed to the instantaneous nature of me seeing your replies. Now what we're going to do is we're going to thin these guys down here. And I've got a little dropper thing that's just got white spirits inside. You can just take a brush to it also, but these things are dirt cheap and it's just faster. And what we're going to do is, you can see how that starts to break down. that thick, heavy oil paint into something that's a lot thinner, something that's virtually a glaze. Initial washes, initial glazes, whatever. It could be just about anything. There we go. We're going to keep thinning this stuff down. Now, I had already done that process on several of these, like I said, because I didn't want you to just see me endlessly doing this. I wanted you to see this process. Normally, I say when I'm doing my tutorial videos for the Patreon page, well, those, I've already got the paint out there, because first of all, people are going to be more familiar with it, because they've seen this before. Saves a little bit of time, but for a lot of you, this may be the very first time you've ever seen oils that are used, so let's have fun with this. So again, just thinning this down. Right now, this is about a Mig Ammo oil brusher consistency. Now it's just a touch thinner. And we're going to hit our raw sienna. See how reddish that looks by comparison? This will sound a little crazy, but what are your primary colors? Yellow, red, and blue. Essentially, this is our red. The Payne's gray is our blue. And believe it or not, the raw umber acts as our yellow. Actually, I have a video that's all about painting yellow, and brown features very heavily in that. So what are we going to do? We're going to take this guy right here. And we're going to do, again, this is really more of a preliminary glaze right here. And as we do this, you can see we don't just stay with one color. See, now we're almost into Payne's gray as we get towards that flail weapon, whatever that is right there. Now we're going to keep moving along here. Now, when I do this in acrylics, oh my goodness, it's a whole different entity, because I've got to work a lot faster. Because when you see what happens with this stuff, you'll really understand why. Because we're not just going to pile this stuff on and leave it. Not just going to pile this stuff on and leave it. Here we're going to work in some of our raw sienna here too. And I know there's people already that are just terrorized by this. They're fleeing. They're just, what is going on here? This does not compute. What the heck is happening? It's going to make sense in a second. So here we go. Just about ready. Going to throw a little more Payne's gray on there. So we've got ourselves an unholy mess. What in the world's going on? Sponge time. And see what we're doing? We're wiping away a good portion of it, not all of it. Because there wouldn't be much point in doing this if we didn't leave a chunk of that behind. Now, it's another little thing too. So you can see how much is coming off. This is a little thing I like to do with a scissors here. We cut this. It does two things. It gives me a whole new area of sponge to work with. Not that these are expensive. So it gives me a different shape. And that shape, what's it going to let me do? Let me get down in here. Let me get down in there. Because otherwise the sponge would just be bouncing off of areas that I don't want it to. Anyway, let's try this right here. And we'll just take a little more away here. You don't want to lose all of that. Well, let's compare now. Yeah, I think we've got one that's pretty much the same weapon right there. So we have some darks, we have some colors in there, we have a little bit of everything. Okay. Now here I'm going to show you the skulls on the base, because this is going to be another tutorial that I'm going to be working on. And again, it is, here we go. Here's the rest of the unit here. So this is the, oh, I don't know if these are the hunters or trackers, what these guys are here. Yeah, they're under the camera there. So see all those little skulls right there? That is another tutorial video. That's going to be coming up on the Patreon page really soon. And here's another individual right there. So you can see we've got a few of those skulls that slipped in there. Now, I just want to go to the oil brushers here. As I wanted to introduce you to these. So they come in a big set. Here we go. This is the big set right here. This is 20 of them. I think there's two sets of those. You really don't need all 40. You can get smaller sets like this. You can get individual ones. And for those of you that say want to use metallics, I had no luck finding metals in oils until these guys. I think they've got a good 8, 9, 10 metal colors. These are really nice. Pigment's really fine on those. The metal flakes, really fine. Not like other oil paints where it's almost like you're just using metal shavings or something. And there will be some future videos where I go ahead and use the oil in a, was that TMM, true metallic form, whatever. I'm going to do the same thing. Might just do one more of these guys, maybe two more. Just want to use up what I got here, and then we're going to advance into the next stage. We'll get the oil brushers out there, and we'll have some fun. Question I get all the time is, so what's the deal with oils? Why use those and not just regular acrylics? Well, when you're doing something like this, where you have massive amounts of guys, and anyone that knows Free Folk knows there's a whole bunch of them. There's a lot of them. Oh my gosh, I think you're looking at potentially 10 units of 12. So that's 120 figures. The process works a whole lot faster. A lot faster when you're using oil paints. Why? You'll see as this goes along how easy it is, especially on anything that's got neutral colors like this, to get all kinds of really nifty color blends. I don't want to say without even trying, because you are. But my goodness, you can really do some nifty stuff. Alright. Here we go. Time for sponge. Sponge again. I'll hit that. Again, the idea is to preserve some of what's there. And what you do is you leave behind some of the blue, some of the red, and some of the brown. So we've essentially got a sharpened tool there now, which means we can take away some of this. That's good. There, we'll just do one more. So here's the other pose. I wanted to make sure I did all the different poses. I think I threw out just enough of this stuff to be able to do all three poses. And you can go more liquid on this stuff, less liquid. I've experimented. Heck, I've even gone with just straight paint on the primer. We'll get to the primer in just a second, actually. Right after this guy. And since potentially it's a new audience here that hasn't seen much of the oil painting, oh my gosh, I can't believe some of the, either. Well, the questions that I get asked, that's okay if it's a question. But I've heard people make these statements of, oh no, oils, that's going to destroy the miniature, it'll destroy your primer. And my answer to that is, maybe step back and listen to that phrase right there. If you're saying primer can't handle a paint going on top of it, you might want to look into maybe a different primer. Because I have been using the Badger's Dino Res, well, for years, many years now, with absolutely new issues. I've even You're talking about a guy that paints, and I just did this the other day, with rubbing alcohol and weathering powders. If that's not going to be harmful to a primer, way more than oil paint. Oil paint's very gentle. It's gentle on your brushes. It's actually probably... It can be more gentler on you. You know, if you're using a cobalt blue acrylic or phthalo blue acrylic, it's really not something you want to munch on. So here we go. We've got now, again, you can see the difference here. It's got a little bit of tone, right? I'm going to check over here, make sure there's no one in the chat. Don't see anybody. We're going to grab a jar of the Steinores primer here. Again, Badger Steinores primer. I put it on with an airbrush. You can brush it on. We used to brush this stuff on for years. We've still technically brushed it on for many more years than we ever sprayed it on. Here's another example. So this is another Free Folk right here. This is one of your Savage Giants, and that's that same primer. Dusted a few different colors on it, starting from a darker brown all the way up to a lighter color. And let's take a peek at what a finished giant looks like. There's the same guy. And there you have it. I think I've got 4 of the Free Folk giants I'll be working on. Alright, what the heck. I'm just gonna, with what I've got here, gonna hit this last one. Because that'll pretty much use up my preliminary wash material here. Let's get some of that Payne's Gray. Again, it doesn't have to be fancy. Doesn't have to be fancy whatsoever. Here. Over the course of this, maybe as I let something set for a little bit or whatever, take a breath, I can show you some of the other units that I've already painted for Song Ice and Fire, because the plan is that at Adepticon I'll be using my Lannister force, and I'm going to have to add to that because apparently you have to have 2 different lists. I didn't know that, and that's sort of a unique thing with the Coleman or Not tournament rules. I don't know if they actually make you use 2. I guess you have to have a second one in case. Whatever in case means. So here we go. We remove some of that. Grab another sponge. And now we're ready to go. So let's load up that palette with some oil brushers, because now we're set. Let's throw out... This is one of my favorites, the rust. Really enjoy that. I'm going to get back to my camera controls here. Going to turn down the color intensity just a touch. There we go. So put some of that over here. It's going to look an awful lot like your burnt sienna. A little bit of a difference, though. This is a fun color, a red primer. I really like that one. Get that out on the palette now. I'm going to put this field gray. This, again, another handy one. I use it in my historicals all the time. We're going to plop that over here. You don't need a lot. Another important thing with these oil brushers, you get a lot more out of them. I'll just put it that way. A little goes a long way, whereas, say, with oil paints, well, acrylic paints, you need a ton more. So we are going to throw out an ochre. Yeah, a lot of these are colors I use all the time anyway. So here's your ochre. Throw some of that out there. We're going to throw out a little bit of this light tan here, medium soil. I have a lot more, many more colors. Sometimes I'll throw them out. Sometimes, let's throw a little bit of this light blue. It's just sky blue, just so we have it. And then I've got this off-white, I think it's yellow bone. Yep. Is this on the pallet? It is still on the pallet. It's another advantage when you're doing armies, or just a lot of guys in general. And you can see where some of those colors work their way in here. So you can see there's a bit of green there. You've got sort of a yellowish white. All right, that's your yellow bone. Look at here, we have the green. We have some reds in here. This is almost like a bluish brown, almost a bit of a gray. We have almost like a purple, blue, black over here. All of these color variations, so much easier to achieve quickly. Quickly when you're doing the oils. And I'm going to throw a few figures out in front of you here. So here's a little bit of an example. This is current Army Painter series that I'm working on, some Morgul Knights. They are also the same way. So here we'll crank up our brightness a touch. You can see some of that. You can see we've already even started to get some rust in there. But look at all these muted colors. But there's greens, there's reds, there's all different kinds of colors. Let's see, I think this one has some more blue. Yeah, I can see almost a little more turquoise in some of these areas. And that's what we want to be able to do with these guys. So let's start out. I'm going to grab some of our... Here we go. You can see how this really flows so nicely. Let's throw some right here. And each one of these guys, I'm trying to make them a different, slightly different color here. So look what we're going to do. We're going to take some green over here. And see how that initial glaze mixes in. And then as we bring it over here, the red and the green start to mix together. And we can even take a little bit of a bluish tone. See how we just brush that right in. See how it just mixes in. Just a few general brush strokes. We can even lighten that up a touch. Here, let's get that now. You can see it. So see how that just practically blends itself. Let's throw some of that in here. Let's throw some of that up here. And again, the idea is you're going to work more opaquely. But you can still glaze. You can actually still glaze with these oils. And you can glaze wet oils on top of wet oils. I do it all the time. I did not think that was ever possible. When I first started doing these, that's one thing I'm never going to be able to do. Would you believe it? I did that. So here we go. See how this is much thicker? It's almost straight up tube thickness. Let's get in here. There's a reason for that. With oils, I try never to throw rules out there. You know, you must do this, you must do that. Try never to do that. I try to give you options. It's all about options. One thing it's physics. There's the law of physics. That's a rule. Thicker paint sticks on thinner paint, vice versa. So, since our first layers were essentially really thin paint, what does that mean? It means our next layer on top of that better be thicker, if we want it to stick. And you say, okay, well, you work thicker, then what do you do after that? Well, then you start thinning down the paint again. You thin down the paints, it'll stick over the thicker paint. And believe it or not, you can wander back and forth. You build up the thicker layers, and you say, all right, miniature. And the miniature lets you know, oh, yeah. Miniature will say, it's time to start working thinner again. You're piling up way too much of this thick paint. You go to put some paint on there, and nothing's going to happen. And then you go, oh, all right. The other nifty thing about oils is, for the heck of it, let's say you don't like that color, right? They say, oh no, I messed it up. Now I gotta strip this whole figure down. Well, not really. See what that just did? Wiped it all away. It's all gone. And I say, oh, well, yeah, I'm gonna do this color instead. hard to do that with acrylics on the fly. Just throwing that out there. No. Hey there. How's it going? Yeah, sorry about that. It takes me a while to see when people are actually writing some messages to me. So I got a little bit of that ochre here. Just trying to work in as many different color variations as I can. So see, we're going to work this in here. See how that blends a little bit. So welcome into the live stream. If you ever have questions or anything, or if you say, hey, could you back up and let me see this thing again? That's why I try to have as many figures as I can out here to make that possible. So that I can go back, rewind a bit, and here we go. I just drop this stuff in here. Now we can screw around with a little skin tone. I just took some of that red primer color and I'm just throwing it in here. I'm letting it mix. I'm letting it mix with the hair. I'm going to let it mix down here on the base. I'm going to let it mix here and over here. And let's see, which one is that? That is this one here. So you can see what we did here. A very different type of cloak. This one's more of a grayish type cloak. The artwork just kind of shows everything all different. It's a mob of people, basically. That's all it is just a big old mob running around, killing stuff, doing like you do. Here, let's get a little bit on these skulls. Now I have to keep in mind that on stuff like this, the all the free folk, snow is a major part of the theme. So I can't have these skulls be too light. Don't want them too light because then they'll fight with the snow, basically. Now, yeah, we can keep going lighter and build this up. Let's get some a little bit of color on the bones here. And then we can go a little bit more, say, grayish. Like this, we got a light bluish gray. Do this on this flail. There we go. So if you're new to this channel, you haven't seen anything before, if you subscribe, that'll get you alerts to these kind of live sessions. This is what we did in a previous live session, and we also did this with the oil paints. It's one of the more recent ones, actually, so you shouldn't have to dig too far back to find it. Since then, we've done some mud effects, we've done the snow, and we've done some blood effects on there, too. Neutral, yeah, they really do suit the free folk. It's almost like I'm painting bolt action figures again. It's hilarious. So what I'm going to do here, I got a little bit of that gray. I'm actually just going to introduce that right into here and just kind of fade that in. It's something that you can't really do that with acrylics. No, you can on a single figure, maybe two. But good luck trying to essentially wet blend across an entire army of maybe potentially a few dozen figures. That's going to be a tall task. That will not be easy. This makes that easier. So here, let's start to lighten up some of this here. And see what we can do. Do a couple of brush strokes, but I don't know if you can see it on the end of this brush. We've got some of this existing reddish colored paint. So we have to go back, get a fresh dose of paint here. What are we going to do? We're going to take this and just brush that down. You need to be not precise, but you need to be direct. You can't screw around. So I think what we've done here, we've gotten some of the paint out of the brush, turn it into a kind of a filbert brush. I'm going to tip this on its side where you can see it. And what are we going to do? We're going to do a little bit of blending here. So I got to clean that again. You're going to have to do this one more time. And we'll see how that just disappeared. Look at that. Here, let's and go back to my camera controls here. We'll zoom in. Make sure it's still in focus for you. Now clean this again. Get this where you can see it. And poof. That's how many layers of paint do you think that would be in acrylics? How much time do you think that would be? If it takes you even just 3-5 minutes to do that, times 12, times 10, 120 guys, that's a significant time savings right there. And none of us has infinite amount of time to paint our armies. All right, so I'm going to go back to the chat here. Oh, yeah. What are they? The cutthroats and the bastards girls. I've got those. And, well, those would be perfect here. You got all those dogs. You can put each one of them, really make them a different color without having to struggle so much. So we're going to do the same thing. Same thing. We're going to go right here on the top of the head. And poof. Gonna change this up a little bit here. Let's get the ochre and some of the white, well, off-white. And drop a few here. Now, let's see what we can do on this. Right here. Drop that in. We're gonna go here. So we'll do, we can even have a separate brush that we use, maybe even for some of that blending, but I'm just going to take the brush that I've got here, set it on its side where you can see it, so you can see that line right there where that brush stroke ended. What are we going to do? We're going to go after that edge. I'm going to feather that right out of there. Practically looks like it's been airbrushed. Now, some of the fur, we don't necessarily want all the fur to be just white. We gotta have some kind of color to it. And let's keep going. Drag some of these down. And actually, before here, I won't get too much farther into this. Now, we saw the oil brushers, but you see, I'm using this other paint, too. Let's see if I can get this underneath the camera here. I think I can. It's a little bit zoomed in. Let's see this. It's a set of 10 oil colors here. You've seen me already using the burnt sienna. Let's throw out another one here. For the heck of it, let's throw out this cobalt. Or is this ultramarine? Yeah, ultramarine blue. I'm going to throw that over here. Just so we have it, just to play with. You can see again, it's really thick. That whole set, what was it, $25 on Amazon? It's minimal when you think of how long. I've been using that stuff for years. I think I first bought it 3 years ago. And I've used it continuously since I've got it. And I haven't had to replace any of the colors. Won't have to replace any of them anytime soon. The nice thing about that is you can add to it, and I've done that. I found other colors that I've added because some of the, I've expanded into, shall we say, higher chroma projects, where it's not just a bunch of earth tones like this. And that makes a big difference. There's a lot of nifty bright colors out there. There's some purple oxide, some red oxide. They give you a little different flavor. So even though this is all wet oil paint, what I'm going to do, make this, see how I just manufacture that into a filbert brush again. And I'm just going to drag this. It's not a dry brush whatsoever. A couple of drags brought out all of those shapes again. That's what I'm hoping that people can get out of this, is that you don't necessarily throw some of the conventional wisdom on its head, basically. I know that's... I don't know how that sounds. It probably sounds scary to some people. I hope not. I hope they're willing to give it a try, because I've seen people try this stuff, and heck, it's hard to get them to not use it anymore. And they're not necessarily using it for armies. In a second, I'll show you a bust that I did. Actually, I think virtually all the busts that I've painted were with oils. Here we go. So we'll let that sit for a second. And here it is. Okay. So this is going to be another tutorial I've got coming up in the next week. So this was done. This is a Blackheart Models bust. This was done mostly with the Mig Ammo Oilbrushers. You can see all those different greens, tans, and everything. The eyes, all of that stuff done with oilbrushers and regular oil paints. Because why not? Here we can start to throw some lighter tones here and even on here. See, I'm just dragging this across just to start to get some lights there. Eventually, I'm going to start to use finer brushes and see how those go. I'm just trying to work in, see what some of these details are. Try not to familiarize myself with this too much beforehand. I think we're going to hit the face a little more here. Another thing, and this didn't occur to me because I don't think of, what's my first layer? I don't even work in layers when I'm doing acrylic stuff. With oils, layers are gone. You're not working in layers. You're working the entire surface all at once, everything. That's just how these things work. That's what they're made for. They're not made for, okay, you paint your dark green, then you paint a lighter green, and a lighter green, and a lighter green. You sort of work everywhere at once. I remember I was telling you before about that, being able to glaze on the wet oil paint. We'll do it right now. Why not? Let's do that. We're going to do that right here. And you can see the capillary action of the oil paint. See how it's starting to bring out those spikes there. That's wet oil paint glazed on top of wet oil paint. We're going to do that here in these crevices. Now, if you're going to do stuff like this, you can see... Here, let's do it right here where you can see that. So I just touch it. I'm not brushing that in. I just touch it there and it sinks down by itself. That's important because oil paints have a natural capillary action. They're thinner than water. I guess that's why they float. They don't have the surface tension that water does. All right, here we go. See around this little bone thing there? Look at that. I can go right around that. Now, nobody's more surprised than me that I can do that, because when I first started using oils, you can bet I was not doing stuff like that. I used them as close to traditional oil paints as you could imagine. See, I just dropped in. All of a sudden, there's shape there where there was none before. We're going to do that here. What I can say is, let's say you're new to it again. This is a new thing for you. You're not quite so comfortable in being adventurous like this. You could wait for the paints to dry. There's nobody with a sword at your neck saying, wait, you got to do it while they're all wet. Now, you do what you need to do. It's your miniature, it's your paint, your brushes. You do what you want. Here, let's drop a little more of that dark in there. Can do that around his feet here. You see, it doesn't take very long at all. Here, let's get some darker glaze in here. We'll just have him with dark hair. Again, I'm just going to my controls here. Just want to make sure I've got a focus for you here. And we'll continue on with some more dark glazes here. I can even almost go with just thinner there. A couple of forces at work. You are essentially replacing some of the oil with thinner, which means, let's move this aside. That means it's going to dry faster. The less oil, less dry time. Now I'm going to eventually experiment with the Optilung. There's like a couple of different mediums that they have. I'll experiment with those, see if I like them. Again, I don't really want to make the oils dry faster because the whole point of using them is because they don't dry fast. When people ask me, so what do you use to make them dry faster? I say I use acrylic paints. I know that's kind of a smart answer. We won't use the rest of the term, but that's kind of how it is. It's important that the things not dry quickly. So I can get lighter and lighter and lighter. Here, let's go after the flail there. Do a couple of these. And I can always think, all right, there's going to be blood on this, probably, because I'd like to have some spatter on the snow. These guys are, after all, sort of the orcs of this world. And we all like to have orcs with blood on them and that sort of thing. See how we've got all the nifty contrast going on there? And we have plenty of room to go. So here we see we can still go lighter there. This is another aspect of the oil paint too. So when you have brushes that are really kind of beat up like this one here, that are really just in kind of nasty shape. Now the oil paint sort of acts like a conditioner, you can call it that. And it sort of brings your brushes back to life a little bit. Here, let's lighten this up a touch. And again, if you feel more comfortable painting this over something that's a little bit more set, more dry, just wait for it to dry and work on something else. You can see how we can just work this right in. Just hammering away at this. Right, so. Now what we could do is we have one of our guys that's a little bit more dry here, which means we can, now this is not totally dry, let's see what happens. Okay, yeah, this is actually dry, and I can tell you right now, I was working on this barely 40 hours ago, probably not even that long ago, and it's bone dry. Now the advantage is, you say, well, okay, now you just lost all the advantage. Well, here's something else I can do. So I just plopped all that down, but yet, remember how I blended that stuff on the wet surface? I can do that also on a dry surface. Here, let's get a little more of this blue-green color here. Get this where you can see it. So I'll drop some of this right here. Sorry about that. It's, oh, is it dry in the house today? Remember the little blending trick we did before? Now this is over dry paint. Well, guess what? Now if you want to just completely clean off the brush too, that's okay. Let's see how I could scumble that across the dry surface too. There, let's get some of that old paint cleaned out of there. There we go. Let's go back to our lighter tones here. And like I said, you can do all kinds of nifty glazing. You don't have to necessarily work when everything is wet. I know I'm throwing out a lot of information all at once. Now, if you want it in a more digestible form, where it's not quite so frenetic, you can see up on the screen there, it says Patreon, it's got my name on it. Well, that's where you can sign up to see instructional videos on stuff like this that really takes you through the whole process. This is a taste of it. They're pretty similar to what's happening here. No, hey there, Mr. Bedar. It's another busy day. Because Adepticon is now only... We leave in 8 days for Adepticon. Which is kind of... Well, not kind of. It is horrifying. That is definitely a terrifying thought. That it is just only a little over a week away. I need it to be more like 5 weeks away. But hopefully you enjoyed the third episode of the Morgul Knights video. I think I put that up maybe 4 hours ago or so. That's one of the newest Patreon videos. There we are. So I'm going to be painting a bunch of these units. I've got to finish off the Flayed Men that you were watching the other day. I'm going to be doing Knights of Casterly Rock, Spear Wives. I have to do the rest of the Mountains Men. Actually, I have to do a unit of Crossbowmen. And that's just the Song of Ice and Fire stuff. I have a whole bunch of other things. I've got some Nocturna videos that I'm going to be working on. That's a really fun miniature company, large-scale figures. I think I've got 3 of those in the works right now. I've got creature caster videos in the works. So it's not just about the army painting. There's actually a lot more going on. Lots of stuff going on. I think, what is it, series 8 Well, I'm working on them simultaneously. It's either going to be the Mountains Men, or it'll be the Spear Wives. Probably the Mountains Men. The Spear Wives, no matter what, I will be doing a video tutorial on this sort of basing here. You can see I'm painting it now. This is the little skeleton on the base here. Let's see if I can find some of that material here. Now, yeah, here's some. This is from Green Stuff World right here. It's called Crunch Times. There's, I think, 5 different types of this. There's the sort of a boneyard type thing. And then there's the one you just saw that's primarily skulls. So here, let's keep going here again. Just because the oil's dried, that doesn't mean we can't still take advantage of what they do. So let's get some eyeballs in here. One more on the other side. There we go. Get some of the fur lining on that. And what's nice is that you can see, you can go back in with some more darks here. You can go, you can shift this now. Let's say we want some that's almost more of a purple type color. There we go. So that's the Payne's gray, and that's mixed with that yellow bone. And I just wanted to, there we go. Now we can hit it with a little bit of a lighter tone here. And you say, wow, you really lightened that up. Well, sort of, because like before, you can get in here just like we did on the earlier one. So I can get in there and push that around. All it is just a nasty brush stroke right there. So here we're going to take away some of the excess. I think you've got good angle on that to see it. And look what's going to happen. Look what just happened. And ourselves a nice smooth blend right there. Everybody likes smooth blends these days, right? That's the big deal. We all got to blend everything perfectly smooth. This stuff can really help you along the path to smoothness. That is a really important thing for you. Okay, I'm going to drop some more, get some more darks in here. And I've even got, let's see if I can locate some of my, yeah, I think this is the one that's basically just a single hair brush right here. It's all that's left is just one little hair. Yeah, that's all that's left. One measly little hair. I think what I'm going to do is turn down the brightness a touch there, just a bit. That's better. Turn down the color intensity to a touch. And let's go after our flail over here. Here we are. We mixed in a little bit of the sky blue with that. Let's get a little bit of our same bluish gray into the fur lining in some of these spots here. constantly. See, I just take a little bit of the white spirits, mix that in, gets it to flow real nice. So you see, you can, even with the oil paints, yeah, still get some decent detail. I'm going to try and do here is get a little bit of a greenish tint on the skin here, like that. See if I can do the same on the back of this hand. Yeah. See if I can't drop some of that down inside in the face here. It's a little bit of a tough angle for me to see. I think you guys can see it actually better than I can. And like that. Get some few lighter touches here. I also wanna make sure that I don't go too crazy with light colors on this, because I also wanna do a snow effect on them. Snow and ice on the bases and such, and if there's too much white on the miniature, well, that's really going to be a tough to convince the person looking at it that snow is white. The snow is going to look dingy by comparison. And in terms of snow effects here, let's grab the Night's Watch unit. So this was, I believe this was series 6 right here. So we'll get some these guys out here for you to check out. Here we are. Speaking of snow effects, that's what we got. And this was real tricky, because these guys were, well, they're basically supposed to be black. Right? Well, as soon as you put that snow on there, any dark color instantaneously looks a whole bunch brighter. But yet, like here on this Scorpion crew, you can see how there's a touch of greenishness there. Let's crank up the color intensity so you can see that. See, there's a green, there's purples, there's blues, all that sort of stuff. But when you take away, you make it black and white, you still see there's still shading there. And there's another figure that I always like to use as an example of that. So here we go. This is another one of the Mountains Men. Watch what happens when we bring the color intensity back. You see purples, you see turquoises, and that's just non-metallic metal right there. I see we've got some responses in the chat. I'm going to go check those out. Here, let's turn this intensity down. See what's in the chat. Everyone seems to be doing what look. I do have some old Space Marines that I was gonna do, but a friend of mine, another supporter of the blog Patreon page for a long time, he donated some. Oh my gosh, were they Sigmarites? We always call them Sigmarines because they sort of look like steampunk Space Marines. Those, I've got a handful of those, I think maybe 6 or 7, and what I was going to do is each one of those was going to be, I'm going to try a different effect, different mediums, different effects. Everyone got time to polish their power armor to a high gloss. Yeah, I know when we first started doing the stuff, we did it with pristine. Everything pristine. I guess once I started doing the historical stuff, things had to be muddied up just a bit. And the historicals really did change the way I approach things. It really, really did. My basing that I did that I thought was so realistic, not so realistic at all. So, you know, just kind of absentmindedly been working on this. Just blabbing on here. Let's get rid of some of that paint. What are we going to do? We're going to push some of that around. So I can take some away. Let's go back into this here. Like so. And each one of these, like I said, a dramatically different color. Now that's what was fun about the Knights of Casterly Rock, is that they're supposed to be, well, shiny armor. And later on, I'll show you what those guys looked like. That's another army painting series. Oh, what was that? Series 3? Maybe 4. Yeah, 3 was my Easterling. That's it. They were shiny. That was a lot of gold on those guys. A lot of gold on them. Not so much with the Sky Earth. That was my Lannister halberds. And you saw the Mountains Men, they're going to get their own degree of, let's lighten this up a touch, they'll get their own version of the Sky Earth. It won't be quite so pure and dramatic. So here, let's hit this again. Take the paint away. Let's rotate this around. Now you can see we got a hard edge there. And you can see as we do this, the edge just starts to disappear. Got yourself a blend. Now, where's my little... this must be my one-haired brush here. Let's see what we've got here. Let's get ourselves something that's nice and dark. Where are we at? Yeah, it looks like you can see that. And I think that's the other thing too. People just, they don't think you can do. I've done freehand and oils. We're about to paint some eyes on here. So I think we just gave him an eye, an evil eye that's looking at you. Let's give him another one. I never would have expected, when I first started using oils, last thing I thought I'd be able to do is paint eyeballs and stuff, especially when the oils were still wet. I did not expect that to happen one little bit. Not at all. I thought, at best, I could paint part of the figure, maybe up to 40% of it, wait for it to dry, and then do the rest with acrylics. Made sense. The more I use the oils, the more I realized, I can do more of this. Until eventually I just started to paint 100% of them. Stormcast Eternals, that's what they are. I don't think I've got the big dramatic ones with the wings. Man, maybe I do. Oh, I also have, I think I've got the new, well, new-ish, well, pretty darn new, actually, Saint Celestine. Because, hey, I think I must have painted about 4 of those back in the day, the older ones, including another converted one that I made. So I've got that, and, well, that could be a nice topic, I would think, for a little non-metallic, potentially in oils. Why not? Okay, let's... Now I'm just trying to get in here and show you how I approach taking advantage of that setup that we did. Because what did we have? Was it this guy here that we were just working on? Well, I've already lost track of it. This one. So you can see where we're at here. That's about where we were. Then we started to do this. We started putting a face on him. Let's put some more fun little details on him here. And like I said, you can do more, you can do less. It all depends on what it is you're looking for. Now, since these are mine, I'm looking to maximize the result on these things. Looking for the best painting result for you. Maybe all you want to do is just have them looking pretty decent, but done. Decent but done is, that's a thing. Nothing wrong with that. That's perfectly valid. So here, this needs to be a little more of a color. It just kind of, that's more just the regular initial wash that's there. Gonna get some cooler colors in here, and then we need to find another color for this right here. And sorry about that. It's been a wee bit below normal with the temperatures here. I don't know if it actually snowed the other night, a couple nights ago. It was supposed to. I don't think it actually did. Now let's find ourselves. Again, so you can see. So here we have two of the similar thing. You can see how we're starting to impart a little more values in there. Oh, kind of making it worn and gritty while still being clean. It is now that I don't know if you saw in the Scorpion Crew. I actually did the mud spatter thing on them. Now I did it on the Flayed Men or Flayed Man. That was sort of after the fact. So we'll bring out the Scorpion Crew again. They're just right here. And this was with a few mud effects. And you can see we did that on there. I did that for a extra little bit of texture difference because we had the shininess of the ice and snow. We had a lot of the the blacks, the grays, the greens, and all that. And I thought, well, let's throw in that mud there because it was like an extra layer of flat tone. And it was the warmest color. So you had all this snow, but now you've got this little hint of this warmer color that worked its way in. So let's get some of that yellow bone color back out here again. Because why not? I'm even gonna throw, what is this, the Mecha Green? Yeah. Let's get that out here. I can take the other stuff and make the same thing, but it could be fun to play around with this. All right, is he back in the screen? Yeah, he's back out there. So you can see now I can get in here and really start to pick out a few things. All right, yeah, let's make this lighter. Now let's tone this down. The hair seemed a little too blue. I just warmed it up a bit with some of the umber. Even the fur here, so I can smooth that because that's all fresh. I can, just like I did with the other blending brush, got me rust into the Flayed Man and manage to keep them clean. Ah, thanks. I think it's, well, it goes back to the historical stuff, and when it comes to vehicles, and I just did one. Actually, that was the video I just posted. What was that, earlier today? Well, I guess yesterday at about 2 in the morning, 1 in the morning, something like that. People get cranky when you make it look like the thing has been run over several times. That's maybe taking the weathering a little too far. It's tempting though, because it looks neat. It does. It's dramatic. I guess everybody's always looking for some way to get their miniatures to have a little more of a dramatic look to them. That's certainly a way to do it. Right, let's drop in there. Now, one thing I'm trying to figure out, this is for potential things for the Patreon page, is some way to do more of like a hangout style thing where it can be a little more, well, a lot more interactive. And yeah, I can see your chat and it's great, but to potentially react in real time to questions, now that would be neat. All right, so I'm gonna, this is one thing I don't have out here. This is cadmium red medium, right? Cadmium red deep. I'm gonna throw it over here. I always like to have that so that I can do stuff like this. I'm trying to make this a little bit, see, we got some pink going on here. Sometimes I like to give them pink noses to that whole wintertime thing. Here, I'll just throw that over that snoot there, and even, I don't know if you can see it, it's probably tough to see on camera, but I can see that it's a little rosy, and guess what we're doing it here on the hand? I hope you can see that. Oh, maybe now you can. See, that's a little more rosy right there. Ugh. Again, even with gloves on, even just the other day, my hands were getting pretty darn cold. And the whole thing where the body's trying to get that blood to flow back in there. Yeah, see? I'll give it a little bit of a pinkish tone there. Again. What about hangout via Discord? Funny, you should mention that. Because I just actually signed up for Discord today. I just created an account maybe 8 hours ago, 8-9 hours ago. Thinking that that's something that I could use, because, well, hangouts are kind of going away anyways in a certain amount of months. I do Google Hangouts all the time, but I thought, wait a minute, could I use Discord to create, like you're saying, that private chat room, basically, or a private video hangout where people can watch me paint and that whole thing. There was a couple of things I was trying to hammer out, and one of them was timing, I guess. Because, well, for those of us who are, I guess, like me, natural night owls, and obviously people like Aviad, who is slightly different time zone than mine, and my Australian friends, which now, let's see, 3:18... It must be, what is it, about 7 o'clock at night, something like 7:18. Oh, holy smokes, yes, 7:18 in Melbourne right now. Know your time zones. Wow, that's not too shabby. Well, and in London, it must be 8:18 then. So that's the one thing, is how do you... Or do you just say, look, here's one for this time zone. Maybe do 1 week, it's more American friendly, maybe. We'll call it that. And then another one that's more Europe friendly. So let's go back to... This is where we were, 20 minutes ago? You can still see the wet paint right there. And you can see here we have eyeballs now. We've got more definition. But you can see how this is already less shiny. Especially the Mig Ammo oil brushes. They do not dry shiny at all. They dry matte. Even the regular oil paint, gotta say, doesn't dry shiny. And think about this too. What have we done for most of the time? We've been thinning the heck out of it. Yeah, 1:18 there, so 2 hours behind Vegas, some parts of California. We have friends in Alaska, so they've got the Pacific time. They're 3 hours behind us. So that's the thing that'll be tough. I figured I may have to do some middle-of-the-day ones for some people, then others in the evening. Yeah, let's see. I'm trying to work in some of this green here. Now let's find another guy that's got. This is more. See, we got more of the ochres in here. So let's work on some of those. And I'm just gonna bounce from one to another one. You know, working on different ones here. This is another one where the paint has, it's dried a little bit, if not completely. And I also wanted to get to, see, this face is a little more open. It's not covered by the hood. And I wanted to show you this. So we're going to get in with some greens here. Yeah, now you can see it. I'm going to get in here down into some of the crevices. Bit of green there. Get that, well, for lack of a better term, 5 o'clock shadow going on. Here, let's do some stuff on the hands here. Yeah, I can see these need to be darker in here. Somehow that got left behind. It can happen when you're working very frantically. Hey there, Will. Ever play around with conversions or sculpting or green stuff for Fimo? Wow, funny you should mention that. If you go, let's see, my blog, it's wapeliusblogspot.com. That's going to scroll back across the screen. What do you call it? My guilty pleasure? Something like that is sculpting. I absolutely love sculpting things. If you check out my, there's two key things, the Lizard Man Army and my Tomb King's Army. I sculpted from scratch. Now let's say we'll go by points. So if it was a 2,500 point army, I probably sculpted from scratch anywhere between 400 to 1,000 points of those armies. I scratch built two engines of the gods, as in, or scratch sculpted, as in the dinosaur, the palanquin, or the howdah, all of it. Sculpted the whole thing, and this is another thing I want to do for the Patreon page, is add sculpting tutorials. Now, you mentioned the green stuff. We use the green stuff, obviously, but my favorite sculpting medium, and I don't know if you've heard of this, is epoxy sculpt. I love epoxy sculpt. It has, oh my goodness, it practically has the properties of everything combined into one. A little bit of sculpey, a little bit of green stuff, hack a little bit of Milliput, but it doesn't necessarily have all the disadvantages of those, because each one of those has kind of a bit of a weakness. And for whatever reason, the epoxy sculpt doesn't have those. Because epoxy sculpt, once it's cured, you can still carve it, sand it, do stuff to it. Green stuff, once it's there, it's just there. You can never file it. You certainly can't sand it. You can cut it, and it sort of looks like you just cut it. It might just rip. So yeah, green stuff is, it's not as flexible as far as what you can do with it. And the epoxy scope really lets you do a bunch of different things. Now I had to, unfortunately, I had to sell off both the Tomb King and Lizard Man armies, which has left me ever since wanting to at least resculpt the stuff that I had sculpted from scratch. And I thought if I make it a Patreon pledge, hey, now it becomes a viable thing. Because right now, it would be, well, it's like anything else. I'd have to choose between work stuff and fun stuff. And if I turn it into work stuff, then I can start doing it again. And I really would love to be able to sculpt again. Especially stuff like monsters. I also just put out, this is, well, it's on the Patreon page too, several basing videos. And there was one I was sculpting little mushrooms with green stuff. And I think I got one guy left here. Yep, here we go. So this is actually, it's up on, yeah, I did a video for this. Sculpting these little mushrooms here. Yeah. Glad I still got this guy around. But this was a lot of fun. I'd never done it before. I really liked it. So I'm going to have to do more of that. I'm going to have to find some more reasons to do mushrooms on bases. Because that was just too darn fun. So they were putting some of that green back here in the shadows again. Just trying to let some parts of that face dry out just a touch. I want to see if I can get some eyeballs in here. I'm going to hit some parts of the fur here first. Epoxy sculpt, yeah, the... What did I sculpt for the Tomb Kings? I sculpted... Well, I didn't have them. Well, actually, they never made them. I sculpted a Colossus. I sculpted the Hyro Titan. And I scratch sculpted... I think at one point I actually scratch sculpted six of them. The carrion birds, except mine were two-headed. Because the story of the army was that it was Tomb Kings tainted by Tzeentch. Basically, the Tzeentch god comes along and says, you know what, you guys don't really want to be dead. I can make you real boys again. You just got to do some things for me first. See, I just added my lighter color right in there, brought that detail out. I'm going to do the same thing here on this fur. Well, all of a sudden everything changed. His little pet canary birds, his tropical birds, suddenly became gigantic. They had multicolored wings and two heads. Statues turned blue. Started walking around. Way back when I did the Painting Pyramid Kickstarter painting videos, 53 of them, I want to say a full 20 of them must have had things all in or in part due to different armies. Fluorescent paints, sculpting, basing, so many different things. Related. Here's we're gonna do some knuckles on this. So I would really love to be able to bring back my old fantasy armies, at least parts of them, the parts that I sculpted. Really love to get those back and be able to do some sculpting. So again, it's wapeliusblogspot.com, and there's a column on the left. It's a search column. You look in there and just look for scratch sculpts. Now, since I'm trying to blow your mind here, the biggest thing that I ever sculpted from scratch, 100% from scratch, for you Lord of the Rings fans out there, I sculpted Grond. That's the big battering ram that they used to get break inside Minas Tirith there, Battle of Pelennor Fields. To give you an idea, the base that that thing stood on was 26 inches by 18, something like that. Yeah, or 26 by 16. It was big. Grond himself, even though he was hollow, was about a pound and a half of Sculpey. It was gigantic. Just doing some eyes there. See, now he's got himself some eyes. We want to do that some rosy things on the nose and the cheeks, right? Like we did before. Oh, let's see. Oh, there's a teaser from Jeter. They have some new Lizardmen coming. Oh, what is it? They call him Seraphon now, I think is what they call him. See, we're going to add a little lightness to the cheeks here. Let's get this other one. All right, just in there. Right. Going to add some rosiness to the hands here. Back of his hand. Ever so slightly there. On this one now. That weird little bit of pinkishness. It just seems to indicate that, well, he's kind of cold. What else did I sculpt for those? I sculpted engines of the gods. Oh, I sculpted pterodons. I think I sculpted about a dozen of those. What else did I... Oh, I think I sculpted... Actually, way back in the day, I sculpted a lizard man. Blood Bowl team. Was that your ground in the... Jeez, I don't know if it ever made it into the White Dwarf. When did I... I think I sculpted that back in... 2005 or so. There was another... I sculpted a mastodon for Keltos. It had a howdah on the back that could fit half a dozen figures. Something like that. And obviously, oh, the other thing, oh, I've sculpted smaller stuff. I sculpted, because they didn't have a sculpt, but I sculpted Eowyn for Lord of the Rings. Because I think all of the Eowyns that they had, she was either in armor or something like that. So I just sculpted just Eowyn in civilian clothes. I guess they're coming out with a new Eowyn set of figures for the next, well, it'd be Rohan at war, I assume. Because right now it's, what, Gondor at war? I still gotta get that book. Because, yes, oh, and I guess to get it back to Song of Ice and Fire, for those fans who might have already left this discussion here, the whole reason I'm doing all of these figures is not, well, yes, tutorials, yes, they're fun, I love painting these things, but just like my bolt action battle report videos, that's, I'm going to be doing that with these figures too. So I think in the weeks and months after Adepticon, that's when I'll really be able to get to that. So see, I can really lighten this up now. Yeah, let's turn this over where you can see it. So that's the ochre mixed with some of the lighter color. And I don't know if anybody's a bolt action fan that's watching this. Right here on the YouTube channel, I have 4 battle reports. It's early war. It focuses on France. But you can check those out. That's another thing I'm going to get back into, doing more of those once Adepticon is over. You can see, I'm just going to use my hand. See what I'm going to pop some stuff there and use my hand. Because why not? Here, let's get a little bit of a light there. Can make it even a little touch lighter there. And this seems to be a bone weapon here, so I'm going to try and sneak that away from the bluish gray, because I thought it was more of a obsidian type of thing, but it's definitely some kind of a bone weapon here. I always have something nearby that I can use to do a little bit of blending on that. Let's get that a little touch lighter in some spots here. And for folks that are just coming in on this, I'm using the Mig Ammo Oilbrushers on Song of Ice and Fire miniatures. So what we're using is these guys right here. Looked at bolt action. It's kind of a weird, circuitous route to bolt action, which started with Lord of the Rings. I'm not kidding at all. I'm serious. I loved Lord of the Rings so much. It was my favorite game. The only tournament I ever actually had fun playing in was a Lord of the Rings tournament. Also, it had a lot to do with the good folks that were running it, but I loved the game. I loved it. There's a little less inevitability in the game. There was not a lot of things that if you had this, you just won. It was not like that. Then, well, we kind of got away from it. The store we played it at closed. That had the biggest effect. I mean, when the store you're playing it at closes and then you don't have access to that anymore, that's creates a void. And I tried Wild West Exodus. I loved that game. A couple of reasons. It had a semi-historical flavor to it. And I used to do Civil War reenacting. And it was steampunk, and I'd never painted steampunk figures before. Now I'm going to try and paint some eyes here. And I thought, okay, well, this ticks on a few things. I've never had a chance to paint steampunk before. It was desert basing. I got to do a lot of object source lighting on them. And I said, well, you know, let's give this game a try. And it was a little bit like Lord of the Rings. Again, not quite so inevitable. Here's an eye. But then the company sold the game and all the miniatures to another company, and they completely changed all the rules, changed the fluff. And for me, as you can tell by the Tomb Kings, the story bit's important. As we're just questing to get a second eye in there. So when you change the story and you wipe out all the characters that I had, that's not so bueno. And moved away from that game too. Left me basically with no game. And then they wanted me to play Flames of War, which I tried. It was interesting, but there wasn't the biggest crowd for that either. And I wanted to do the 28 millimeter stuff, and that's when people say, hey, there's this bolt action thing. And I went, really? And I had already had a French army in Flames of War, so I was nominated to be the French for bolt action, which was great. I could do all the research. It's one of the reasons why, well, Song of Ice and Fire, it brings me back to fantasy again, you know, ranks and flanks. But since I never saw the show or read the books, I'm basically researching it like I would research a historical thing, because there's plenty of material on that. So that I love doing the historical research. And the miniatures were so different than all the fantasy stuff that I'd done. In many ways, they're more like these kind of guys here. I mean, they're just people in furs. They don't have two heads or three arms or anything like that. They don't have scales. They're just people. And that's what the bolt action figures were, just people. The Conflict 47 set, we actually have some of that. I've got, I think, the Japanese set and the German set. The handy thing about K-47 is if you have that, you're halfway to bolt action, if not two-thirds of the way to bolt action. Now, they've added a bunch more since it first came out, but in effect, if 90% of your stuff is bolt action figures, you just add the Conflict 47 stuff, you're good to go. You can play both of them. But I loved making the terrain. My battle reports that I've done, they're essentially historical what-ifs. What if the French commander that was supposed to be at Arras hadn't died in a car crash, and they got the orders and they showed up? How much could they have taken advantage of the breakthrough? Would it have actually made a difference? Played it out, and it turns out, oh yes, it made a difference. Well, it would have only been a temporary difference, but it did matter. See, now we've got a little more of the face going here. It's actually really nice and smooth already. Don't have to keep messing around with that. Now here I'm going to see if I can't work in some warmer greens. Like so. Just working in that warmer green. Let's warm it up a bit more, lighten it up a bit more with the ochre. Like so. Now, just because of the nature of what I've got to do for Adepticon, so much stuff still has to be done. I'm going to be doing some of it in the form of the Patreon videos, but I'm also going to do some more of these YouTube lives, so if you subscribe, you should get the notification. We tested it out on Kathy, and it worked, so it's definitely possible to find out in advance when these are going to happen. Hey, Justin. I tried, but the Japanese... That's something that I've heard from several folks, but I think I could swear those... Well, I guess older is a relative term, but I think those are now... They may not be as old as that original U.S. infantry, which... Those were just, they were not the niftiest miniatures in the world. But I'm sure that's something they're probably going to revisit, redo. What's the latest campaign book? They did Battle of France, of course, after I've done an entire campaign in it practically. But the latest campaign book is one I was really looking forward to, Fortress Budapest, because I was... gonna do a campaign Budapest 45, and I've actually already have painted I think 3 Hungarian vehicles. I got a Zerini, a Toldi, a Zaba, armored car. Gonna have to sculpt myself a truck. But when it comes to historicals, I've got 1/48 scale planes that I'm gonna be working on. And one of the reasons I do that is because every time I try something that's so new, like when I started doing the historical vehicles, it taught me, I would not be doing these things like this if it wasn't for the historical vehicles. So let's compare him to an earlier iteration. So this is about where we were a half hour ago. And now here's where we're at, like so. Let's see, I've got as far as the Boltons, I've got Cutthroats, I got the Bastards Girls, I've got some characters, I've got speaking of Boltons, wait a minute, what do we got here? Oh, there's my Varus that I'm going to be painting up for Adepticon, but somewhere in here, there we go. Speaking of Boltons, I think that's the Rus. No, that's the other Bolton. Somewhere in here I've got a Rus Bolton. He's around. I'll be doing him. Oh, and here's another thing. This little guy. Yes, that's the mountain that rides. He's that big. He's huge. He is gargantuan, so he's another thing I'll be doing. I'm going to be doing Spear Wives, like I said. There's a lot of fun different miniatures we're going to be doing. I'm going to get a little bit of this warmer color down in here, but I'm also going to get some darker colors. I'm going to go back in with some, this is some of the Payne's gray here. Get down into the some of the ground elements. So see how we're making that really liquid-like going in here, and look how that just sinks down into those crevices. And I'm going to do another one of those glazes again. So we got the Payne's gray, nice and liquid. What are we going to do? We're going to drop it here. Notice how I didn't mess with it. I just let it go, and it's literally, I can see it slowly creeping down all these different edges. Dreadfort Warden. Yeah, he's been a popular choice in armies. Cut rope by Ramsey, that's it. Roos has a coal man. Speaking of the sculptors, they do all the sculpting for Big Child Creatives, and they've done, especially now with Song of Ice and Fire, all, once you got past the starter box, they were the guys that sculpted everything. So we've had actually, on the YouTube Live, if you look back at some of the initial ones, like painting the Savage Giant and some of the other one, I think Lady Val, one of the ingenious sculptors, he was participating in the chat on the YouTube thing. And I'm trying to set up something where maybe he and I do sort of a tag team, either YouTube Live or some kind of a thing like this, where he can maybe talk about his sculpting while I paint. So see, we're adding in some darks there. We just glaze those in. Yeah, I think it was somebody else that did most of the starter set stuff, and they said once they got past that, then that was all their work, and this is just one of my favorites. I really loved Craster. Really loved this guy. You can see the pink nose on him there too. See some of the pink in the skin tones. You can see some of the purple in there. So let's do that same exercise again. So I'm going to go back to my controls here. I'm going to go back there, and we're going to take away, going to turn in black and white. But yet, you can see all of the values are still there. Let's go back to our color intensity here, bring them back up. Now you can see it just like the other one, all the purples and other color shifting going on in there. But yet, the shading is still there, and that's, I like to call it the fourth dimension of contrast. You know what, let's see if we can't get a little rust going here on this flail. So I'll take, that's mostly the burnt sienna, sort of a natural rust color. What am I going to do? Shoot it once there. Again, just that little drop. Here, let's shift it where you can see it. Another little, if I push it around, oops, sorry about that. If I push it around too much, it's just going to turn to mud. So I have to just drop it, put it there and leave it. That can be a little tough at first as far as discipline goes, because you want to go back in there and mess with it. You cannot go back in there and mess with it. Just don't want to do that. So you can see this is almost more of a cooler color here. See, it works its way back around. Now it's almost more of a red on this end. And I can still continue to work in darks. And here we go. The weapons, the sword especially. Funny you should mention that. What is this, like the sixth time that's happened? The whole reason why I started painting the figures is because this is Mr. Jim Ludwig. He does the Dark Sword miniatures. And yes, I have a whole series of Dark Sword painting tutorials on the Patreon page. I think I'm at episode 13. I'm working on 14 right now. He he loves, yeah, obviously he loves the IP. He really loves his Song of Ice and Fire, and he made sure that those things were sculpted nicely. And when he came up to me at ReaperCon last year, showing me the figures, he said, "Have you seen these yet?" I said, "I haven't seen these." He says, "Check out those swords. Check out those weapons." And I went, "Wait a minute, this is how they come out of the box?" He says, "Yep." And I'm looking at those things going, usually every sword, every knife, every blade, I practically have to re-sculpt it myself, or basically take out an anvil like I'm a blacksmith and reforge the blade. Every single one of those is perfect every single time. See, I'm getting a little bit of lighter green here. A little bit of lighter green. I'll walk this up again. Not interested in a green cloak on him. I'm going to put some of that green over here too. It's just to get that variation. So I'm going to drop some of it here. Now, let me grab, let's see if I can do this without knocking a bunch of them over. I haven't magnetized them yet. There you go. There's your Lannister halberds. This was series 4 after the Easterlings. Yes, that is all Sky Earth, non-metallic metal. That was so, well, I gotta say I enjoyed my Easterlings and my Army of the Dead. Really liked those guys. But boy, I liked my shiny Lannisters. I really loved doing those. Here, I'm going to get this even a little bit lighter here. Man, like I did before, I've got another brush that I've got here that I can use. Do a little bit of blending here. Just softly blend this stuff together. We got some here. See on the end of his sleeve? What am I going to do? I'm going to take in that. Just walk it right up there. We got some on the end over here. What are we going to do? We're going to blend that out the same way. See if we can get some lighter colors here on the hood. We do that. See if we can get rid of some of that. Here we go. We're going to do the same thing. We're going to soften that up. So we've done a lot of different things here. We've got some green down in the shadows of the face. Let's do something with his... Yeah, let's do something with the flails here. I'm going to try and get myself a little lighter gray here. That's the Payne's gray, some of the bone white. And we're just going to go right in here. Just like so. And yes, this is oil paints we're doing this with. Let's see, we got it darker up here. We added in a little bit of light down there. Yeah, when I heard that, what's the phrase? Oh, there's a Lannister always pays his debt, but, well, there's another one that says a Lannister poops gold. And that's why my crossbowmen, they're going to be shiny like that too. I just thought, yeah. And I've got my Knights of Castle Rock. I'll show those in a second. They're all, they got the shiny stuff going on. They've got lots of nifty little designs on their blankets and such. As I lighten up his beard just a touch, and I go back to my smaller. Again, this is a little one hairbrush that's useless for acrylics. It is completely dead for acrylics, and it's gained a whole new life for oils again. Work this in here. So yeah, where's my Knight of Castle? Here he is. So there's your Knights of Castle Rock again. We've got the Sky Earth non-metallics, and we've got our free hand on the horse. even in here. See, there's greens and purples in the gold. Same thing over here. Greens, purples, all of that, all working their way in. It's, to me, I'm going to do it anyway. That was done with acrylics, but if I was doing it with oils, I'd be doing the exact same thing I'm doing here. Trying to work in as many colors as I can. Just makes it a lot more interesting to look at. As I find a few more lights here. There we go. Bar staying wet for like eternity. Practical differences for me, and I say this all the time, the reason I'm using the oils is because I'm working on huge amounts of figures all at once. So we'll go back to our Lord of the Rings figures here. So this is series 7 that I'm working on. I'm actually recording the final episode tomorrow. I've got 8 of these guys that I'm working on, and I was working on them all at once. And this paint is actually still wet. So you can see I'm able to push that paint around. See, I'm able to blend that. I can go in here, go right over the top, and still be able to blend in there. Let's take a little more of this turquoise color here. See how that starts to blend in there? It just by itself, naturally blending in. Let's put a little more in there. A little more. That was, I think I stopped painting these guys at around over 26 hours ago. And all of these guys are just as wet as that. They're still workable after 26 hours. So I can basically bounce back and forth between these guys and those. So what do you got? You got 8 of those horsemen, Morgul Knights, and I've got a dozen of these, and 5 more characters that I'm also working on. Oh, there's your Roos. The Roos is loose. So that's the primary advantage. I can work on all of these figures all at the same time, 20, 30, 40 figures, and the paint stays workable. For all intents and purposes, the figure is now my wet palette, which is pretty cool, especially when you got to paint this many figures. You saw how easy it is to blend these things? It means now what I'm doing whole entire armies, they look like I spent 8, 9, 10 hours a piece when I spent an hour and a half. That is the big difference. I'm even gonna brighten that up, give it a little more of a touch of green. Like so. So we got warmer greens down here, we got cooler greens up here. The capillary action, yep. That's the capillary action. I first discovered that when I was painting the vehicles. Now, I don't know if I've got the... I don't think I have the miniature that I just did. So I just posted, what was that, a few hours ago, the Victoria miniatures. That APC, the kangaroo APC. Now there, I didn't get a chance to use the oils on it, because it had to be dry. I thought I had to ship it out today, so I couldn't use oils on it. Had I known, I could keep it till Adepticon. Well, then I would have tried to use oils on it. But it was on the vehicles. That was the first time I noticed that capillary action. I said, wait a minute, I can do something with this. I can mess around with this for sure. See, we're getting this a little bit lighter here. And I can even make that a little bit lighter. And See how that's a little harsh right there? I can go in here with that brush and just buff that right out of there. So let's see if we can get here. We need some, go back with some lights again. Just going to throw that out there. Hopefully that's still on the palette. This is another thing. I don't know if it'll be a live or a hard copy, but this is from Mears Miniatures. It's a bigger guy. It's by no means the biggest thing I've ever painted. He's just small enough to get under the camera. So a little manticore here, that's going to be another thing. He's going to be done in oils, because while I'm working on him, I need to be working on a whole bunch of other stuff. See, we drop in a few. You can start to think about some lighter highlights at this point. There we go. Let's go back in here. See what we can do with this, the weapon here, maybe on the knuckles. Right? Yeah. Just get that in there. We'll drop some light on the knuckles there. Now that army painter pledged I was talking about all those unit painting things. It's a $15 a month pledge, and you get to see all of the videos that are made that month. Not just the army stuff, but stuff on basing, stuff on color theory. You get to see the Dark Sword miniatures. Now, I do have a Dark Sword miniatures pledge, and that's $10 a month. That'll get you can see the basing ones too. And what that does is, while I try and do as much, work in videos as I can, regular commission things, it's just not always possible because of scheduling and everything else. Because, again, things have to be shipped out. Sometimes, it's somebody else's figure, so they get to decide what colors the things are. And sometimes it makes it not always the best project for a lesson, unfortunately. Let's see, don't know what is about the Kingdom Death Sculpts. Boy, have I painted any of those? I painted one, what was it, the Flower Knight? We're talking years ago. It was before I even did the Painting Pyramid series. And it's interesting. I think what I like about, the Big Child stuff, because they do stuff, Blood and Plunder, they sculpted those. They've done pretty much most of the new Dark Age sculpts. Folds are folds. Faces are faces. Hair is hair. Like that Craster miniature that I showed you, the Lady Val. Yes, there's flowing capes and there's other things. But it's more reasonable, more believable, whereas some other things, especially in the realm of digital sculpting, it's more of a big old blob and you're not quite sure what it is. I would have to have more of those to paint or something like that to really see what they're like. Oh, the other thing I'm gonna be doing is some more Reaper miniatures. I have a bunch of those. Once Adepticon is out of the way, I'm going to do some Reaper painting series like I did the Dark Sword stuff. So see, we're getting our... This is that green stuff world. The basically resin plates. I was surprised at how easy those were to work with. They sat for at least a couple of months. I didn't use them because I just didn't know. That's never going to break. I'll never be able to use it on a small base for sure. Well, you never know till you try. And once I tried, I said, oh, yeah, could have been using them this whole time. So we've got one that is our initial watch. This is what we started with. Here we were. Oh, 2 o'clock this morning. Yeah, definitely an anime vibe. Then we got to this, right? And here's where we're at. We've got our greens. Got lots of different colors here. So where's our... So there is your raider leader, basically. And like I said, I've got a whole nother unit of 12 of these to paint. I'm going to save the blood effects and other things maybe for another episode. Maybe we'll return back to this guy here and start doing some more stuff on him. Let's work on his flail here. And again, that is... Oh, let's see. I think I did a little catalog of how many new episodes I've done. These aren't YouTube Live videos. These are hard copy, recorded, edited, rendered videos. Oh my gosh, I think I've got 60 of them now. It's insane. I had no idea, and more are being added all the time. Like I said, by this time tomorrow, there's going to be a whole nother episode added to the Morgul Knights series. And now we're going to work in some darks, and all of this is wet oil paint. Everything I'm doing here is wet. So what are we going to do? We're going to get a little bit of dark. I'm actually glazing in dark over wet oil paints. Just glazed in some dark. Oh, the Lady Val was one of the first. Yeah, I remember. It was like a roller coaster ride with no safety harness. Oh, we've got her. I'll grab that in a second here. I'm throwing some dark right there. Throwing some dark here. Let's grab Lady Val. There she is. This one was actually done with acrylics here. But remember, we were messing around with the reds, trying to get the green, trying to reflect the snow into the cloth. We were working with the hair, trying to actually get some green in the hair. See, there's some green right there at the edge of the skull. And the whole purpose of that was the contrast with the hand and the flesh tone there. Yeah, this is some of the more extreme monsters. I've never actually seen those in person. I've got a few of them. They're more just the humans, kind of. And they're smaller scale. I don't have any of the larger ones. At some point, I'll try and get to those. But I've got the creature caster stuff. And oh, speaking of Big Child Creatives, somewhere is a package that's coming from Spain that's got a bunch of Big Child Creatives 75mm figures. And I'll be doing videos on those too. I love the Nocturna figures. But I realized there's just not enough of them because I have to keep making videos. So eventually the Big Child videos, those are going to become part of the Patreon page too. And they are sending me multiples of the sculpts so I can try and do them. One in oils, one in acrylics. I've done that with 2 Dark Sword videos right now. I did one figure. I think I did the first one in acrylics. And then I did the second one in oils. The exact same color scheme. Everything was the same. The base was the same. Everything was the same except for the medium. And in that case, it was oils instead of acrylics, because I wanted to show people how there's nothing different between the two. I think one of the questions I used to get early on was, well, it wasn't so much a question. Again, it was one of these myths or something where people said, oh, yeah, you're doing that because it looks different when it's dry. No. If you go back, was it last month when I did the Night's Watch Ranger Hunters, I think they were, or no, Ranger Trackers. Actually, it was both. It was Ranger Trackers and Ranger Hunters. A bunch of them had been done in acrylics, too. And even I couldn't tell the difference between the two of them. I actually had to go in, look at the videos and the pictures, and go, oh, okay, yeah, that one, I did that one in acrylics. Oh, wow, that was in oils. So here we're doing the same thing on the hood. We're just, see how we can buff that. Just buff that paint in right there. Do a little more. See, just a touch more. I'm going to get rid of some of that paint. And we're going to buff away that edge there. It's all gone. And we'll hit this here. So the oils, I've worked on terrain, miniatures, vehicles, you name it, simultaneously with the oils. That's the advantage of them, is I can work on so many things at the same time and not have to worry. All right, you know, these, do I need to stop at this stage? Even when I'm doing my preliminary, like I said, when I'm doing my preliminary washes, when I'm using the acrylics, I have to basically stop because, well, gravity and the physics of things drying. But when it comes to the oils, I don't have to worry about that. Now, see, that's actually wet paint there. But you notice, see how I'm thinning it down more and more? That's why the paint sticks there. That is why it sticks there, because we're thinning it down. Now, there comes a point where I cannot thin it down anymore. I actually got to start working the other way. I actually have to start working thick again. I'll just drop a little more light color in there. Try and pick out a few lighter things here. And whatever these, they must be like little teeth or bones or something. Here to see, find a few lights. Same thing on the knuckles there. And down here. Just finding, and I don't want to go berserk with the contrast in some of these places. As far as, now this is, we can get into things like mold lines on these type of, they're gaming figures, so it is that type of plastic, at least on the bodies and such. That's where the sanding sticks, I found those work really well. Originally started using those on, well, guess what, vehicles and model kits and such. And then saw that they worked really good for getting rid of, because there's different weights of grit. Some of it's heavier, some of it's lighter. So let's compare him to an earlier iteration like the one we started with. You can still see the washes on that are wet. And you've got a nice difference here. We'll spin these around. So let's go back to, speaking of this one, this is a whole different set of colors here. We can go in here. See, I can start to pick out some of that fur. Scratch sculpt on your blood. Oh, if you... There's step-by-steps for sure on the Tomb Kings one. So on the Colossus and the Hyro Titan, I think there's sculpting with that. I know there's step-by-steps on the painting, but I think there's also step-by-steps on the sculpting too. Because I didn't have, at that time, I didn't have the ability to film stuff when I was doing those. All I could do was just take pictures of it. And that's why I would love the opportunity to do that again. It's just, basically, that would probably be its own pledge level or something like that. I also need to, especially do bigger things, like those larger sculpts, even for painting too. I want to do terrain. There's a bunch of stuff I need to get to, but this filming area is limited. You can only get smaller things under here. Like I said, that manticore you saw, that's going to push this to the absolute limit as far as what I can get underneath the camera. So that's why I've got the Patreon page going. I'm trying to do more of the YouTube lives, and well, you kind of have to build the YouTube channel anyways. If you want this around for other things, YouTube wants you to build it up, so figured the stuff has to get painted anyway. Why not turn the camera on and let other people see it? Hey, Bethany, how's it going? And I don't know if you were here. Well, you can watch this from the beginning. Yeah, that's another thing, folks. You can always watch these from the start. But I correctly guessed what time it was in Melbourne. I think it was 7:18. And I guessed it bang on the nose. I know last time, Tim Tams, we were talking about delicious Tim Tams. The greatest candy bars ever made. The days when, yeah, well, the blog was initially, well, it was a bunch of step-by-step photo tutorials like you do. And in 2013, there was a growing, well, it's kind of a demand for video tutorials. And I said, well, that's great, but I don't have a camera, I don't have the software, I've never edited a video before or filmed one or anything. And I said, besides, the stuff I do on the blog is, well, it's free. And many folks said, look, we will give you money to procure those items because we need to see you doing things. We can gather a lot of information from the pictorial tutorials, but there's nothing like seeing an application. It is different, I know. I've benefited from video tutorials myself. I'm gonna lighten the face here, like we did on the other one. I'm gonna get the hands a little rosier, a little lighter. I'll go back to our smaller brush here. Get this going. And that's when the Painting Pyramid Kickstarter was born. I did 53 videos. 12 were basing, because I love my basing. I did 6 color theory ones. I did 5 or 6 flesh tone ones. I even did 5 terrain tutorials. And that's the other thing I want to be able to do again, is terrain in video form, because I had so much fun with those, and I'm going to do Lord of the Rings battle reports. Song, Ice, and Fire. Well, the terrain that I use for bolt action, unless it's a forest, is not really usable for Lord of the Rings, Song of Ice and Fire. So, that's going to require a whole new set of terrain. Those were really a lot of fun. Yeah, what's my favorite saying about Western? Yeah, tomorrow is today. Found that out the hard way when I was watching my Aussie Rules football. And I go, man, that's going to be an interesting time for me to be trying to catch the game. Again, a little bit of the turquoise is going to work its way in there. Into flails. Mix this in. The only thing better than a video is actual in-person masterclass. I think, it was about an hour ago, half hour ago, the idea of a Discord class, right? I don't quite know how that will work. Well, I guess the Discord, it's an invite-only group. It basically is like a Google Hangout, for lack of a better term. I assume that I could use this format, meaning my XSplit here. So those are things I'm just going to have to research. So here's another one of those glazes. So I took the raw umber. It's in kind of a glaze form here. See that, the capillary action. I just touched it there, and I let it do its thing. I didn't try to guide it in there or brushing it. I just had to let it do its thing. Because as soon as you touch it, well, that wet paint, you're going to activate it. And then you'll be sad. Now let's work some red into these potentially skin. So see down in here, this is the other advantage of the oils. And just take my brush and jam that in there. Get a little bit lighter paint. So I did those couple of, and just jammed some paint in there, right? So I'm going to take this brush here. I think you can see that. I'm going to sneak that in there, and I'm just going to blend that together. So now I've actually got this really smooth blend. Let's see how, look at that. See how it's behind his foot there? I couldn't even see what I was doing. I was doing it blind. Literally, completely blind. That's the advantage of the darn oils. It's unbelievable what they will let you do. Not like anything else. There's things you maybe can't do. It might be more difficult for me to do some kind of super elaborate freehand right now. But what's to say you just let it dry and continue later? So again, we're going to lighten this up a touch. Like so. And I can always go back the other way. Watching a live stream of the Grand Sumo turn. Oh yeah, we were talking about that last time too. Not to worry. You can obviously go right back to the beginning of this. Because we're, 2 hours in? Two and a half hours in, basically. I made an unsuccessful attempt to try and get the chat thing working. I'm going to have to do another test where I think I set everything to private and just have one other person who knows that I'm doing the thing live. Give them the link, and then they can tell me, yes, I can see you. I can see myself typing, or nope, sorry, it's still not working. It's hard to do that and all this other stuff at the same time. My original idea was to actually have a moderator. I know Mel, the terrain tutor, he has people that function as moderators who essentially relay questions to him, which is handy. But it's just kind of me here, and, well, you have to be up kind of late, especially if you're here in the U.S., because it is now 4:26 in the morning here. We're going to add a touch more light in a few places here. And like I said, we can always go back in with a darker color like that. We've got to get some definition here on these, on the back of the hand. Remember that rosy color that we did before? Need to sneak some of that in here. Just like that. Same thing over here. So now that starts to coming closer to this, but you can see now the color differentials, especially here. So you can see where we have the reddish brown in one area, we've got more of a yellow, more of a tan, where we have more of a green. Now it's more of that reddish brown. But yet there's a transition here. Transitions from kind of a gray-green to the reddish-brown. Yeah, the old Central Standard Time. So, yeah, I used to... Well, I still do the blog. Actually, the blog now has 5.3 million views, something like that. I'd have to look to see how many thousands of articles that I've done, but it's got to be somewhere in the neighborhood of 3,500 articles or whatever. Because I started the blog in February, I believe, of 2012. And I've been posting essentially once per day, every day, for 7 years. It even scares me when I think of that. So that's basically 7 years of tutorials, ideas. Sometimes I just discuss ideas about things. So I'm just adding a little bit of light. I know it's kind of shiny there, a little bit hard for people to see. I'm going to try and do maybe some brown here on this. So we're going to get some of the ochre in here. That's the Mig Ammo Ochre. And I can lighten that up a touch. Here, we'll get this. Sometimes if I can change the angle just a bit, you don't get quite so nuked by the shiny. Can make some of these things a little brighter here. Like so, we gotta get some lights in on this flail here, and then we'll do a little bit of the rust type stuff on there that we did before. Yeah, let's drop a few lighter colors there, and now just like we did before, so we're gonna some of the burnt sienna, right? We make it into a liquid by adding the white spirits, and it's really just like any kind of, looks like it's acrylic. I'm just gonna drop it there. I'm gonna drop it there, let it go. I drop it there, let it go. Some more of that. And the process that I did there, it's very similar to what I was doing on these guys here. So you can see some of that same kind of weathering going on right there. I can even take some of this, maybe even glaze it into some parts of the hair. Again, there's always some different type of color that you can throw in there to keep things as different as possible. So see what I did there? I just threw in that light there. This was dark. I didn't want to keep making that lighter. So what I did was I just accidentally hit some lighter colors over here. I said, you know what? I'm going to make the inside of that lighter. Let's see if we can, you know, we'll lighten up the ochre a little bit here on the edge of this. Like so. So now a little more contrast between what's on the knee there, and again, we've got our little blending brush here. So we turn him over this way. I think you can see that. And that was looking a little rough. Now it's not so rough anymore. Gonna do the same thing over here. That is now scumbled in and blended. All right. Now, speaking of bolt action and stuff, I know Justin's posted a whole bunch of really neat, bunch of fantastic new German infantry there. Those gotta be the new plastics, which I think my friend has. I don't have the new trench-coated, overcoated plastic Germans. I gotta get a hold of those somehow. I do have the DAK. As far as bolt action tutorials, I've got five desert armies. I got British 8th, DAK, Bersaglieri, Vichy French, and Free French. So yeah, we don't do stuff small, we do it big. How's that? Yeah, I just, again, change this a little bit here. Now you can see that. So now that really separates from what's underneath it there. There, let's see if we can't get a little bit of an edge here on this flail right here. Work our way down. And all of this stuff is completely wet oil paint. I will let it dry, though, before I do the blood effects. And I tried something new. Oh, I think this is it right here. Yeah, it's a ghost tint. Again, another Badger product right here. And that's what I did for the flail here on our flayed man. You can see I spattered him with it. Also, I took some anti-shine and I basically killed the shine on the stuff that hit his pants. You see we did it on the snow there too. And I've got more of those that I'll be doing probably in combination of YouTube Live and also for the Patreon page. So I'm going to go back to the Payne's Gray here. I always have that fresh and available on the palette. I'll throw in a few darks here. And Work our way in like this. And I hate that black lining term. So I just basically got that Payne's gray with a bit of the white spirits. Knocked down a few edges there on the fur. Let's get some more definition here. I like that. Can't always have this handy. Push that. Get that. Again, another. Just, it's practically like an instant blend. It's amazing what you can do with those. I never, ever, ever thought that was possible. But it's definitely possible. Here, let's go back the other way on this. There we are. Let's get a little more dark in there. We can refine that shape a little bit. Let's get into some lighter skin tones here on these knuckles. Like so. Do it here. Now I'm going to go back the other way. I need to get some green actually on the skin. Got a lot of pinkish tones, but we need a little bit of green right here. That's it. That is what I needed. Needed just a touch. We're going to do the same thing on this side over here. That's what I needed. And that's basically like a little glaze over the top of that. Let's find ourselves another one of these to maybe play with here. So where's one that we just hit with our glaze? Yeah, let's try this one. And let's see if we can, you know, play with maybe a slightly different set of colors in here. So we've got this cobalt blue over here. And you mix that together with the raw sienna. See what we can make out of that. So let's see, I've got a filbert style again. And here we go. This is a little bit of a, we're going to work backwards here a little bit because, well, Bethany didn't get to see the beginning, and this is sort of what was happening at the beginning. I'm going to hit this here, make that darker. So you can see we've got more of a dark bluish gray going on here. Like so. It already starts to establish a bunch of contrast. And I'm going to take some of that pink skin tone color. So now it's almost like it's purple. You think, what in the world? Now it's not going to register as that when you see him in the whole entire unit with everybody else. It's just going to have a slightly different appearance. There we go. Just like we did before. Remember, got to go back, get some fresh color again. And we're going to do a stroke right here. See how it was blending as I was brushing it down? You can sort of do that with acrylics, kind of, sort of. But with oils, it's kind of a natural thing. You don't have to have a couple of brushes. You don't have to put in any retarders or mediums or anything like that. That's how it works. It's designed to work that way. So here, let's buff this out just a bit. I can even go a little bit lighter. Yeah. like that. Just a touch lighter. So it's practically pink that we put in there. Look at that. Maybe I'll go in here. That same thought. Same idea. Now let's go into some. This is the umber. The raw sienna. Go in filbert style once again. And in here. Gonna get down in here. Same thing. Over here. And, yeah, go back in here. So, filbert style once again. And now we've got a more of a dark brown working against that lighter purplish gray. Now we've almost got, see, I'm taking some of that ochre now. And we're going to try and I'm going to do the same thing here. How's that? There we go. And now that's going to contrast with our more of a bluish purple that we got. And then what are we going to do? We're going to take this. See, even there, that oil brusher that I put out, what would you say, maybe 2 hours and 15 minutes ago, that is almost, it's almost dry. So I know that's always the question of how long does it take for these things to dry. It's kind of variable. There is no direct answer. As we just throw a little lighter color here for the bone. So again, what we're just going back to where we were before we started to do more detailed stuff like what we did on this guy. But now again, we've got different colors. So here we've got that red and the tan. And now we've got this much darker version. So Bethany has paint a large army quickly. My first choice, well, yeah, it would hopefully be my first and only choice would be going with the oils, because it would just be so much more relaxing. It would get done. It would get done faster. Now, of course, here's the caveat. As long as I had time for all that stuff to dry, because it's not going to dry the way acrylics do, which is pretty much darn near instantly. But because of Adepticon and having to get things done so fast, so many things, that's why we've got this surge in the oil painting, because they really have to have the same painting goodness as the acrylic stuff, but I have 1/8 of the time that I thought I was going to have. Actually, more like 1/10 of the time, if that much. And you can see how we're able to. Where's our first? Yeah, this is a guy we just picked up after we were, what, an hour and something in? And all he had was just the preliminary glaze stuff on him, and now all I'd have to do is do the blood and snow effects, and he's done. Now, would I prefer to spend 4 or 5 hours per guy at least? Oh, definitely. That would be the ideal. But that's not the reality. So now the Lannister guys, I'll show you them again. These were painted all with acrylics You know, let's dig them out of here. So all that was all acrylics there, doing the sky earth, non-metallic metals, doing the bits of freehand on the robes and such. But obviously we had time. Now here's another. So this is the assault veteran that goes with him. Now, this freehand stuff that's here, it would be really tough to do that over wet oil paints. I could do it, actually, if I needed to. But on some of the other Song of Ice and Fire guys, I'm going to try and do this sort of stuff. The non-metallic, sky earth, whatever, using the oil paints just to see what happens. Because I haven't tried it yet. I've done non-metallic paint on other individual figures and monsters, but I haven't had a chance to try it on a whole unit. I did it on the bolt action Soviets, because that was another thing where I had to paint a whole freaking bunch of guys and not a whole bunch of time. The Morgul Knights, they're going way faster. Because, again, the oils. I just have to remember that, you know, the downside of that is going to be that, you know, they won't dry so fast. I'll have to be really, really careful trying to play any kind of a test game with them. When you do the acrylics and the army painting, folks, they've heard me say this a bunch of times. That notion of, well, you paint part of the army, or you paint, say, 50% of the figure. Then you take it, you go play a game or two. Maybe you want to make adjustments to your army, something like that. You make adjustments to your army, you paint some more, play again, play test again, whatever. There we go. Just, again, working that in. Got my other brush here to do some cleanup when it's necessary. Then I'm going to do a little bit of I'm going to get that around his face. Because the whole idea is the context. That's why I don't prime things white or black. If I had to choose just one color primer, it would be a neutral gray. That's for sure. Actually, I think almost all of the original painting pyramid stuff was primed neutral gray. Because if you prime something white, everything you paint next to it looks dark. If you prime it black, everything looks light. And that's when you find that the face is too dark because you painted it next to black armor, and then all of a sudden you painted the light armor in its place. It's just, when you think about it, you need to know the color of what's next to things. This is the other advantage of the oils, because you're painting the entire surface at once. Painting the whole figure, not just painting a part of it. You know, not just the fur, just the face, whatever. You're working on all of it. So I just grabbed a little bit of ochre, because that was starting to get a little bit too white. So see here, that's more of a pinkish color, but on that side it's more of an ochre color. Yeah, Bethany, the oils, and this is the nice thing. If you just got, you don't even have to get the set of 10. What if you just said, okay, I'm going to get four tubes of paint at $4 a piece, whatever. For $16, you have four tubes of paint that will last you forever. You can try them out, see if you like them. Then you can add to it slowly. With the oils, this is not going to be like, well, even when I'm using acrylics, you'd be lucky to see me use more than 10 colors on any miniature. I don't care what the heck it is. When I did my watercolor stuff, I very rarely ever used more than 7 colors on any painting. So they were just writing some ochre in here. And again, this guy, what did he look like? He looked like this. Just, what, 5-10 minutes ago? And we're talking, we're having a good time. Well, I'm talking and having a good time. Hopefully people watching this are. And let's go back to the ochre once again. And let's see what we can do in here. I'm just going to drop in some of this. Boom. Like that, all haphazard and crazy. Now I'm going to take ourselves this brush here. Like what we've done so many times before. I'm going to pull this stuff around and blend it in. Here, I think you can see that. Yeah, I'm just walking that right up that fold. Yeah, let's do that here. Yeah, just basically a line right there. Line is gone. And do the same thing here. So we're basically mixing that ochre color into the purple that was already there. The dreaded resin cleaning. That is the one other nice thing about these is that no one have to worry about them. Well, I guess they can break, but you can pretty much drop them on the floor and know that they will not shatter like a resin piece, unless it's a resin vehicle, in which case you drop it on yourself and it hurts. Tell myself it's okay to splurge since you passed on the scale 75. Yeah. It's so funny because the people that were buying those, it seemed to be like they were the same folks that told me they didn't want to do blending. That they didn't want to have to, like with the oils, they didn't want to have to thin the paint down because it was coming out of a tube. Pretty much all the stuff they're going to have to do with those paints were things they didn't want to have to deal with oils. So that was, it really, I wasn't sure if it was the whole, you got to have the latest thing. Yeah, that's, we're like that. We see somebody else with something, and they go, oh, wait a minute, I think I might want that too. If I had those, I know the first thing I'd do is be doing two-dimensional paintings with them. I'd break out the watercolor paper and watercolor board and maybe some canvas board, and I would start doing me some regular 2D paintings. Because if it's got that the qualities that they say it has, that would be really nice for actually for doing acrylic paintings. So I'm gonna try something here. So I'm gonna take some of that seafoam green. That's again one of the Mig Ammo oil brushers. And this is gonna be, it's actually a glaze here. Cause I tried to point out when I'm doing the acrylic things that glazes aren't necessarily just dark. They can be light also. See what I just did there? I turned that a little more of a grayish green. Oh, and for those of you that have seen a lot of my non-metallic metal demos, you know I am very fond of that whole concept of green and purple make gray. They make a fantastic gray. So see, we've done that here. It's purple there, and now it shifts towards this lighter green. Now let's see if it could be, well heck, it could even be, well, let's see, an awful lot of Warlord vehicles are resin. It could be Cruel Seas, resin ships. I haven't actually seen those in person yet. I'm sure they'll have them at Adepticon. I don't know whether I'll have the time to go see those. So I'm going to make the inside of this light again, like I did on the other one. So again, that was that light glaze that I just did there. Now, we're going to shift towards this thing here, and we're actually speaking of purple. We're kind of using that. Here, let's get some of that lighter stuff. Spin this around so you can get a view of it. Yeah, well, these, speaking of resin, okay, these flails right here. It would be a horrifying thing to be dealing with these if these were resin. I think usually with stuff like this, if it was resin, the first thing I'd do is just either cut it off or break it off and just put some kind of a pin in there and pray that it didn't break on the other side of the pin, because I've had that happen. Resin, definitely not one of my most favorite materials ever. Now, not all resins are the same. Some resins are really resilient, really strong, almost silky smooth, and then there's other resins that we'll just say are not so good. So I got a little bit of blue in there. That's that sky blue that we set out way at the beginning of this adventure. And again, for the folks that are new, that's the Mig Ammo Oilbrushers here. 96 metal ottomans. Oh, I'll be prepping metal myself. I've got, I think it's 48 figures to prep for my class that I have to teach at Adepticon. Yeah, something like that. That'll be fun. Now, there's not many parts to them. I believe each one is maybe two parts tops. But still, that's another thing I love about the Song of Ice and Fire figures is they're all one piece. Now, dealing with the mold lines can get adventurous. Twenty-four fine cast elves, they're not the Lord of the Rings elves, like the Rivendell elves, not Rivendell, it was the Lake Town or something like that, they were Rivendell elves on the horseback. What was the, for my Easterlings, it's not Camul, the Easterling, maybe it is, Amdur, Master of Blades, that's a different hero. But one of the ring wraiths is an Easterling. That would be fun to have. All right, so this has, we're going to get a little more color to this. So I'm just going to drop that in there. Grab our blending brush again. Get in here. And so we've got ourselves a little bit of a blend. Now let's turn this over. Get it where you can see it. Soften this up even more. And this is just the fun stuff that you can do with the oils. It's not possible with the acrylic. So we're doing this again. We're going to do some fun. So there's a little bit of green in there. There's some reds in there. Mirkwood Elf. That's it. Oh, Rivendell is fine. Kiss spears. Woof. It's like you almost just say, you could say, screw it, I'm going to get other spears. The only problem is that Lord of the Rings stuff is in true scale. Yeah, that makes it tough. Now, I guess Perry Brothers, they sculpted a lot of the Lord of the Rings stuff for darn near all of it anyways, I suppose, but usually the Lord of the Rings weapons tend to look not like just regular things, not regular swords, regular lances. They have all that elf curviness to them and everything else. So this is a case where didn't want that to be like that. I can just move some of it away. Let's get this edge on this flail here. And every time I do these little things like this, I'm always just amazed because my first visualization of the oils was not being able to do this kind of stuff in any way, shape, or form. So again, we're looking to do the rosy nose there on him. Let's get back to some of our brown here. Get a little shading. I'm going to try and hit the mustache here if we can. Well, I can. Can you see it? That's the primary concern there. Get the lower lips there. Let's again get a little bit of the rosy color here on the hands. Blend that a bit like that. Now I'm going to get some of my lighter color back out here. And a skin tone, really all it is some kind of a red, some kind of a yellow, and some kind of a white. Alright, so see, we'll mix a little red in there. Let's make ourselves some, see how close we can match my skin here. Let's see how close that is. So I can add a little more red to it then. Yeah, so it's not difficult to make your own skin tones. I try to stress that you can buy flesh tones and all that sort of stuff, and it's never going to be right because it's never going to match the environment that your figure is in. It's just like those non-metallic metal sets, which is great if figure is standing in a display case, like as in the person is standing in a display case, not moving anywhere with no trees around them, no sun shining on them. Because all that stuff makes a big difference, the environment around them. And I'm going to go some darker color here. We get the separation in between these fingers. It doesn't have to be really dark. It just has to be a little bit lighter. Let's see if we can find some more darks in here. Maybe inside the hood here. Above the eyes. Now, let's go back to the base here. We got these skulls sitting here. Gotta do something with those. And we can go, I'll go back and grab that tray of guys, because this is, I do have a step-by-step, just a photo thing on the blog of how I made these bases. Let's see if we can grab some of these without knocking them all over this time. Here we go. So see, this has a little bit more of a forest theme. Again, that's the green stuff world, skull and bones texture sheets. So here I'll put these guys down. We will not knock them over. And this is it. So again, from green stuff world, they actually sent me some new paint and such to try out, inks and other things, but they're also sending 5 or 6 new texture rollers that I haven't tried yet. And I think one of them, oh gosh, I don't know if it's Lions. That's the one I'm using for the Lannisters. But there's a Necron type texture. There's a Tau. There's an Eldar texture. So when those come in, most likely after Adepticon, I will do tutorials on those. Some of them, I think I might do a more generalized thing and say a YouTube Live. But then I'll do some real specific ones for the Patreon page. And again, that's if you want to see more of this crazy kind of stuff. Bethany was kind enough to join in on the fun. And her, she keeps getting blitzed with one crazy idea after another. Kamu is the Easterling. Okay, he has that gold mask. Yeah. Because, let's see, there's Amdur, Master of Blades. There's the Dragon Knight. The Easterling, the War Priest. Oh, that was my favorite. My Easterling War Priest. I had mostly Cataphracts. Actually, I had Cataphracts with some Candish allies and chariots. It was a fast army. And with the War Priest and the drums, made him even faster. That's one of the things. That's why I did them in the very first Lord of the Rings series. Because I unfortunately had to sell off those guys too. Just like my Lizardmen, Tomb Kings that I had sculpted. It was sad to see those go. But this is another series that I did. Because one of the other things I wanted to get back was my Army of the Dead. And I think that was Series 5. That's where I used the green fluorescent paints. So I got a nice start on a Army of the Dead. I think I've got about 12, 14 guys painted up now. The one thing that nobody's made for me in oils yet, and I've heard that it's possible, is fluorescent oil paints. I would really love those. Alright, here, let's mix the ochre and the red together. That I want to keep this separate from the skin tone. Keeping that separate from the skin tone. In fact, I'm actually going to accentuate the pinks there. So I don't know if you can even see that, but let's not have big old hair on the brush. So here's a little more of the red. Get this down, and we're just going to drop some of that in there. I think if I was doing that with acrylics, I would have had to do like a crazy little wash and stuff, and it's just so much easier to do this and then blend it in. So we need to get him some cheekbones in here. Like so, one there, another one there. I'll see if I can drop in some eyes on him. I'm definitely, fatigue is starting to set in for sure. So let's see how steady we can be with this. Actually, do I even have the right, oh yeah, okay. This is actually my little one-haired brush right here. Trying to get it where you can see it. There we go. He's kind of looking up there. See if we can... Here, we'll get him some more. That's the Payne's Gray. So now he's got himself some eyes looking at you. Not a real friendly look right there. And so let's see what we've done. So we got our two guys here. See, even the fur has a different tone to it. So the fur on this guy on the left, more of a white, cool white, and this has more of a ochre to it. See, the pants, a different color. Completely different colors on the robes and such. Some of the Easterling, oh, at ReaperCon 2017. Oh, and Angmar with the Witch King. Oh, Barrel Whites, those were really neat. Oh, and Spectres. The Spectres are really... did I paint one of those? No, actually, someone gave me, I think for Christmas, they gave me a couple of the old Spectres. I wanted to have a whole army based on those guys and do the Dead Marshes, terrain-wise. So I think I may still do that for Lord of the Rings, make myself the Dead Marshes. Now I've got, I think they are handy, right? Yes. So the texture rollers here, this is more of a cobblestone, flagstone type thing. And on the blog, I've got a whole bunch of articles on how to use those. Now, somewhere, I have some bases that here we go. So these are for the Morgul Knight. So there's one of those. That's that roller I just showed you. So that's... that one painted. Here's a combination of the roller and the skull texture. This obviously is skull, and this is my tree bark basing. That's just skulls there. So you can do a lot of different things. And like I said, that's the series that I'm working on right now, the Morgul Knights. I think I got one guy that's finished. Here we go. So that's what they're... There we go. So there's your finished Morgul Knights. With the rust effects, got the leaves on there, got some grass. I think the horse even has some glowing eyes. It's a little hard to... There you go. You can kind of see that there. Like I said, that's for... We'll be concluding that, I think, tomorrow. Well, not tomorrow. In about 13 hours, I'm going to be filming that episode. So let's get a little more of this in here. Let's go with a few touches of lighter stuff here on the hands, on the knuckles again. Bring those out like we did on the other ones. Rohan. That's the Rohan I'm working on. Foot troops and mounted, all kind of at once. That was going to be the original Series 7, but I thought I'd save those for the post-Adepticon where it's a little less crazy. Oh, thanks. Appreciate that. I didn't have any of this stuff when I was last doing the Lord of the Rings figures. There's a lot of amazing new tools that are out there. It's really a golden age of miniatures. That's what I always say. Now here, this fur, I don't want this to be lighter here necessarily. I almost want that to be a little bit on the darker side. I'm going to add some lights in here to it. A couple of shots here. And all of this paint is wet. Everything that you're seeing is wet paint on top of wet paint. And yet you can clearly see very distinct Put the cover there, it stays there. Put the cover there, it stays there. It's a management kind of thing. You're managing how thick it is, how thin it is. You're trying to recall, okay, so how thin was my last layer? Well, the paint will remind you. It will remind you very quickly. It'll say, yeah, you need to go thinner. Go a little lighter here on the cheekbone where possible. On his mustache and beard. And we're gonna try and find a few more lights here on his arm. There we have it. And I think we are gonna put out a little more of that's the light color again. It's again one of the oil brushers. It's called Light Flesh. It's a very pinkish white. It's pretty much the equivalent of the Maiden Flesh color that I use all the time in my acrylic demos. Just looking to put more of an edge on that. Get some of that on the here. There's some kind of stitching there. Do some of that. Let's see if we can't lighten up some of the parts of this bone weapon here. There we have it. Man, like I said, once these guys are dry enough, I can do my snow and ice method. And I just got some new heavy gel that's going to show up. That's really handy. Because I'll just set him aside real quick, and we're going to find something that's got some icicles on it. How's about our... yeah. Like this guy here, a scorpion crew. So see those icicles hanging off there? Off of the scorpion. I've been really having a lot of fun doing that on these... on these kind of bases here. Now, speaking of bases, this is... the texture rollers again. And let's grab these, my Lannister crossbows. And check that out. That, again, is another texture roller there. That's from Green Stuff World. And the reason I chose that is because, I don't know if you can see that rampant lion there. You see the lion right there? Well, that was pretty much perfect. Look at these little things where it says strength. So this is how I'm going to base my Mountains Men. So that's another tutorial that's going to be coming up. All right. So here's our... this is our three guys that, again, when we started this, they had basically no paint on them whatsoever. They were just primer. There we go. And what I'm gonna jump off here, guys, because it is now 5:20 in the morning my time, and I need to catch some sleep for tomorrow. Just want to say thanks to Aviad and Justin and Bethany, and oh, here we go, and our first last, because he was first. And he got to see the stream and everything else. So if you Wanna? I guess you can. I guess you can do the like and share thing on a YouTube Live. I suppose so. Makes YouTube happy when you do that. It makes me happy too. I do hope that people, when they see these things, they just, it gives them ideas, stuff that they can do on their own figures. I'm going to scroll the chat back down here again because I don't want to lose track of that. Never knew the rollers had so much detail. What's the average dry time for oils? Well, as I've seen with these oil brushers, it could be hours. Like a matter of 3-4 hours, they could be dry depending on how thin you make them. Well, thanks again, everybody. It's appreciated. So I just did a little quick thing right here. Thanks a lot, Justin. I'm hoping to do one of these again just potentially as soon as tomorrow night, but probably the night after that. So, like I said, you subscribe. Oh, thanks. Thanks, Casaris. Appreciate it. And there's other tutorials like this. Wow. I mean, actually, just even this, it's not dry. But this is what I call paint that is set a little bit. It's not dry, but boy, I was moving the brush on and the paint wasn't moving that much. And this is just like 40 minutes ago, maybe 35 minutes ago. So it can, now it depends on how much you thin it. Really, that's the big thing. If you thin the paint down, you have less oil. It'll dry faster. Now, the other thing, too, if you use like a piece of cardboard as your palette or paper towel, something that's really absorbent, it sucks some of the oil out. And that just, it changes your drying time there. Because you're taking away some of the oil. But I hope this is fun for you, because we basically went from stuff like this right here to something like that. So again, you can try out the oil brushers. And I've got lots of fun other live sessions and videos all about those, working with the oil brushers. So thanks again, everybody, and I will catch you real soon.